We have our two experts joining me this morning. You certainly heard from Dr. Tom Go yesterday, and today Dr. George Koo is also with us. But I need to start this morning, in terms of this segment on the umbrella revolution, with a disclaimer. It's really important I say this because sometimes when organizations put on programs, they're misinterpreted, you know. So I need to say this. We are not endorsing Joshua Wong, okay? We're not endorsing the umbrella movement, but we're also not apologists for China. So it's very critical that you keep that in mind. It's the same thing when you're in the classroom. Sometimes we have personal opinions as teachers, and we don't want some student to go back home and tell mom and dad, dang, that teacher, you know, it's all about China, it's nothing about these Hong Kong people, or the other way around, you know, these Hong Kong people all messed up, you know, and it's China, that's right. So you're gonna have to keep that balanced perspective and keep that teacher's hat on. And that's why I need to say this, because we struggle with that as the 1990 Institute, because we want collaboration and education, you know, in terms of what we do on both sides of the Pacific Ocean. So I start with that disclaimer. I think you see this picture, you have seen it. If you haven't, certainly it's a prominent photo of Joshua on the cover of Time. And it's kind of in line with what the Western media was doing. So if you look at what the BBC was saying, he was the, you know, political superstar. Or if you look at what Canadian broadcasting was saying, he was the mastermind, you know, of the umbrella revolution. And then if you go to the New York Times and you look at the little snippets of video they have, 2.5 to 4 minutes, it's really arousing and inspiring, you know, what he's doing and everything. And in fact, some of the rhetoric, not so much from him, but from the people around him and others who are not even in the student movement, who would get up, you know, at one of these demonstrations during that 79-day period, and they would make these speeches that would just basically, you know, send you to the moon. And one fellow in particular in one of these snippets, and you can find this online, Dennis Kwok, who is a member of this, of the Legislative Council. You will see that later, called LegCo, for short, you know. It's something that you have to remember, LegCo. But he's a member of the 70-member Legislative Council. And it was instructive to listen for just, you know, a few minutes of what he says, but he says something that this is now in front of hundreds of thousands of people. What we are seeing tonight in Hong Kong is the purest form of courage on the planet. It is the kind of courage that would change the politics of this country. It is the kind of courage that will bend the arc of history. Those are words, frankly, that are tailored for Western ears. It's something you might hear on the floor of the US Senate about any topic, but when it comes to China or Hong Kong, wow, you know, it's powerful. So I just want to tell you that we need to be careful what we hear, but we want to respect, you know, what was happening. And so today you're going to hear from a number of people, and we're going to start, from a number of people, of course, including our speakers here. But the key interviews are going to be, of course, with Joshua and with Nicole Kwan. And I need to tell you that Nicole came in June. She actually lives in San Mateo, but she goes back to Hong Kong to teach. And some of these slides, you know, and here, I just quickly flashed through some of them, are in the PowerPoint that you received. And it's all, I think, done from a professorial point of view. And it's a good one, too. I think a lot of facts, a lot of data, you know, and why this and why that, the numbers that she would give, you know, the economic factors, and the kind of tensions that exist, and some analysis, and all her information is with sources. And I think that's why it's important to keep in mind that when you look at stuff here, and you look at the end of her PowerPoint, she has sources for you. And that's kind of important. So all that as part of her presentation, I just want to give you that kind of, you know, clue or insight into what she did. And so I'm going to ask now that her interview be played. And George, thank goodness, was able to do the interview for both.
I'd like to highlight a few things about the umbrella movement that I think maybe people are not fully aware of, and I think it's important to understand. First of all is, I would say, the biggest civil disobedience movement in Hong Kong. Before that, we had protests that involved many, many people. During 1989, there was a million strong protest against the Tiananmen incident. And also in 2003, there was a protest of about 500,000 against the enactment of a National Security Act, if you will. And so this time is calculated that, well, estimated that close to 1 million people were involved one way or the other during the 2 months of the movement. It is a very unique moment in Hong Kong's development. The protest is very much aimed against the National People's Congress, the Standing Committee's decision on the election of the chief executive of Hong Kong for 2017. That was announced on August 31st. After the announcement, university students staged a boycott of classes as in protest. And on September 28th, as I mentioned earlier, a sequence of events turned it into a mass movement. They were objecting to the restrictions on the election of the chief executive, which was promised that this would be done on a universal suffrage basis.
Okay. Talk about how the chief executive was selected in the prior election, which is 2012,
right. Mm-hmm.
And comparing to what was proposed for 2017.
So in 2012, before the NPC Standing Committee came up with their decision, the chief executive was elected by an election committee of 1,200 people, right? With the decision of August 31st, the election committee was essentially changed into a nomination committee, and there were certain thresholds that the NPC had set. One was that the number of nominees should be 2 to 3. And second, any nominee has to have the support of 50% of the nomination committee. This is interpreted by the protesters, especially, as being restrictive. It does not qualify under their understanding of universal suffrage. Now, as to take a step back, the basic law, Article 45, provided for election of the chief executive by universal suffrage, right? And to be nominated on a broad democratic level. And at the same time, the basic law also provided that this would be done on a gradual basis in accordance with the situation in Hong Kong, right? And the NPC had said that in 2017 that there would be election by universal suffrage. So that was a promise, if you will. So when the decision was announced, it was felt that this was not truly universal suffrage as a lot of people would understand it. And that this was, in fact, had become more restrictive because the threshold for nomination had rose up to have risen up to 50% instead of the 1/8 in the previous election mode.
The MPC or the Hong Kong government stipulate how the 1,200 members of the nominating committee would be selected?
Yes, I mean, there are definitely mechanisms for selecting. And so if we based it on the election committee that existed in 2012, it's by a represented by a group of people who are selected or nominated. And essentially, the constituencies is a group of about 260,000 people. So from the protesters' point of view, this is a very restrictive provision.
Yeah.
And what they would ask for is for the nomination process to be opened up to the public, or a combination of political parties and the public.
So talk about a little bit about the coming vote that will be taking place in LegCo, in a week or two?
Here we are, today is June 12th.
Yeah.
And June 17th,
okay.
The decision of the NPC Standing Committee, as I described it earlier, will be submitted to the Legislative Council for a vote. And it takes 2/3 majority to pass it. So there's contention on whether it will be passed or not. And the situation is quite fluid right now. And the latest poll that I saw was that those who oppose the passing of the decision is now polled at some 43% versus those who are for passing the decision is at 41%.
Okay.
So it has just passed the,
right.
Yeah.
Okay, let me clarify, just
right.
for the record. The opposing means not accepting
the NPC decision
from the National People's Congress.
Right.
And approving would be the
to accept
proposal.
It. Yes.
And the proposal is again?
The proposal is that the chief executive will be nominated by a nomination committee of 1,200.
Okay.
Right. And then there are certain stipulations that the nomination committee will nominate 2 to 3 nominees, and each nominee has to pass the threshold of 50% acceptance by the nomination committee.
What happens either way, the vote goes one way or the other? What's that? What does that mean to the people in Hong Kong?
I think that it takes us back to what I like to characterize as what emerged from the umbrella movement. From my personal perspective and from the polls and surveys and comments that have come out since the start of the movement, we see that there is a pretty deep divide. First of all, between mainland officials and the protesters, and secondly, even among the people in Hong Kong. Okay, and I would characterize this divide in the following ways. First of all, it's a clash of political and social values. From the mainland authorities' point of view, their governing mode is or has been a centralized, a top-down government. Whereas Hong Kong, especially protesters, are demanding a more localized, more flexible kind of government authority. And then, secondly, there are certain what we call core values, come to be called core values, that are standing in opposition in this particular instance. Okay, you have one hand, the desire for national unity, national power, economic prosperity, stability, and these are highly valued among certain sectors of the Hong Kong population, and of course by the governments of China and Hong Kong. On the other hand, there is a demand for more at an individual level of freedom of speech, democracy, of freedom of elections and so forth, which it turns out it's very much the position of the protesters.
There's some people think that the protesters are really influenced by outside agitators. Mm-hmm. In other words, foreign influence. And foreign influence probably implies United States having an active hand behind pushing the protesters. Mm-hmm. What's your view on that?
Well, I was in Hong Kong during the second half of the Umbrella Movement, and I visited a lot of sites. I talked to the students. I have to say I don't have a firsthand, I don't have any evidence that there was that kind of interference, influence. And the government obviously has also claimed that there is a certain amount of foreign influence and that they have evidence. But this was never publicized.
Is the contention that before the handover, under the British influence, there was no universal suffrage. In fact, people in Hong Kong didn't get the vote at all. So from that point of view, this has been moving in the right direction.
Mm-hmm.
As a fourth generation Hong Kong Chinese, what do you say to that?
Well, I think, first of all, as I mentioned earlier, universal suffrage in the election of the chief executive and also for the Legislative Council elections are written into the basic law, okay? And it's provided also that it will be on a broadly democratic basis.
Yeah.
And the basic law also includes other provisions that it shows very clear that this is the direction that the Chinese authorities have agreed that this is the direction that Hong Kong will move forward. So, in a sense, especially for the younger generation, and the basic law was first promulgated in 1990, so they grew up with the basic law in place, many of them, right? And so this was promised, and from their point of view, this was a commitment that they would hold the government to.
And they don't feel that the government is living up to the basic law.
Right, that is their feeling.
Don't you think that the Hong Kong government is really a middleman with not much room to maneuver?
Definitely. Definitely they are in that position.
Yeah.
On the other hand, we look at the students or the youth movements, and we also see that, first of all, like many sort of more or less spontaneous youth movements in other parts of the world, we do not see a unified command. And there are many groups with many ideas. Okay, there were two more organized groups. One was the Federation of Hong Kong Students, and one was Scholarism, represented by Joshua Wong. These are more organized groups to start with, but there are many other loosely organized groups, many of them organized by through Facebook and internet, chat groups and so on and so forth, who have different ideas on how to approach certain issues, different ideas on tactical issues and what they really want. So among the students, there was we come to say that there was no one big platform. So there was no one central command, no mechanism to really poll or the or have some kind of showing of opinions and coming to a decision, right? So we see really impasse in that situation where one side, there's not much room to maneuver, and the other side, they cannot come together in a unified course of action. With the voting that's coming up, either way, one, we go back to, well, we are in the status quo. There's no, the decision is not implemented. Number two option, the decision is implemented. So either way, the group that is not satisfied will remain dissatisfied. And because of the nature of the movement or the protesters and how loosely they are organized, my concern is that we're going to see a increasing, probably not just polarization, but possibly a radicalization of protesters who feel that they are disenfranchised, that they do not see a parliamentary route to being able to push forth their demand.
The Hong Kong Chinese, the younger generation, older generation, has never experienced what a democratic process is all about. And in some ways you alluded to that when you say, you know, all the protesters don't have a unified voice. How will they arrive at a long-term solution that they can be happy with?
Well, that's a good question. Now, if we look at other examples of youth protests and how they interact with government, I guess the closest example in time and in kind of social situation or political situation is the Sunflower Movement in Taiwan, which has happened earlier in the year. In that particular situation, there was a resolution in a way for the time being under parliamentary means, which was a committee was set up to look into the issues, right? So in Hong Kong's example, there was no such resolution, no matter how temporary it is. And that left, you are left with a large active group of youths who feel that they have no parliamentary means to advocate their positions. And it's hard to tell what kind of actions they will resort to. There have been a number of polls during the movement and afterwards as to what are the critical concerns among this group of protesters, right? And from the polls and surveys that I have seen, it seems that the more political concerns are at the top of the list. Okay. And economic concerns with income inequality, with the inability to rise in society, to get ahead. That is mentioned as a concern, but it's not among the top concerns. So if we look at that kind of information, I guess we can say that, yes, certainly it can improve the situation and bring greater stability within society, but does it resolve a lot of the issues that were raised and that might continue to exist depending on how the political situation pans out? I think that will be of great concern.
The handover and the basic law applies for 50 years, which mm-hmm. means it's in effect until 2047, right? 50 years from 1997. If I do the math, it's 2017 is still 30 years from before the basic law runs out.
Hang on. I don't think the basic law is going to run out. The basic law is really the mini constitution that Hong Kong's run.
Okay.
Now, the 50 year comes because Deng Xiaoping, who came up with the idea of a one country, two system, has promised that this would continue for 50 years.
Okay.
Right? Now, the original premise was that in 50 years' time, mainland Chinese society and Hong Kong society would develop to the extent that they would it'd be easy for them to merge, and there will not be that kind of vast difference that existed during the 1980s, which was when this concept first came up.
Right.
So that 50 year is a, if you will, a more philosophical question rather than a constitutional question.
And it sounds like what you're suggesting, it sounds like rather than getting closer together, the two are moving further apart.
Yes, I think you got the point there, and hit the nail on the head. And this, especially after the umbrella movement, I think this is one critical development in that the two, the mainland society and Hong Kong society are moving apart. Now, obviously, I can't say that for all of Hong Kong society. Within Hong Kong society, as I mentioned, there's also great polarization. Those who support value of national unity, identity, great economic prosperity, and those who value individual freedoms and so forth. That will continue to exist. And in fact, I think we can characterize it as a generation divide from the numbers that we can see through the polls and surveys. People who are 30 to 50 or above have a greater sense of national identity and loyalty to China and so forth. And whereas the younger generation is less so. So yes, there's certainly a development that is, should be of great concern to the Hong Kong government and to the mainland government and to Hong Kong society as a whole.
Now, just very quickly, moving on to Joshua. It's a kind of a different interview. And you will see what I mean when it's played. But Joshua did try to convey his point of view through the PowerPoint, because I think the PowerPoint, in a way, gives a view of what this young man is. But when you hear him, it doesn't quite exactly match. But I think it's important, certainly to see his point of view, because he uses the word what the Chinese use, really, brainwashing. So that refers to the national education movement that he spearheaded in 2012. And really, he was given the credit, through the hunger strikes and all that stuff that he did that forced the government to back off on implementing the national education curriculum. And the other way to say it is that the patriotic, education agenda that they wanted to so-called force on the Chinese schools, the students in Hong Kong, it got shelved, and it was made voluntary. In fact, a principal from Hong Kong that Tony and I know, Dr. Will Chan of the Hong Kong Baptist University affiliated school, told me that all the schools were given at that time 500,000 500,000 Hong Kong dollars. That's about 84,000 US dollars. And they were supposed to use that to get materials and do teacher training. He told me many of the schools did not, it was actually given to them, and it's in their account, but they haven't touched it. They haven't touched it since 2012. So there's money provided by the mainland government given to all the school principals. Some may have, he doesn't know who, but they think that once they use that money, it meant that you are committed to this movement, this change in the curriculum, and they didn't want to do that. So that's something that came directly from a principal in Hong Kong. I want to ask a question very quickly. Did you notice I made a mistake in my opening remark? Did anybody catch it? Oh, okay. I said umbrella revolution twice. Now, that was something I heard on TV during the whole time I was watching this, and subconsciously, even me, it came out when it's the umbrella movement. The term revolution was never used by the protesters. And the word revolution, it's like a red flag for the Chinese government. So you see what happened to me? All right, I want to make sure you check yourself when you're in the classroom, okay? So just quickly move it on. Exactly, George. I knew George would have a good word there. And so all this stuff that he puts on there is from his personal perspective, and you're going to hear George. You're going to hear Joshua. Here we go.
I'm Joshua Wong, and now I'm 18 years old, study in Open University of Hong Kong and major in politics and public administration. Actually, I've participated in social movement for more than 4 years already.
So what does national education mean? What does that mean?
I think actually my starting point is the national education subject. It related to around, I think, 4 years ago, the education department of Hong Kong would like to launch the subject named national education, and it hoped to enhance the secondary school student to be to love the nation, love the country, or even love the Communist Party. And I think this starting point motivated me to participate in politics and social movement. Yeah. Okay.
So what does national education mean? What does that mean?
Actually, national education it means a compulsory subject that every student needs to learn from primary 1 to secondary 6 for totally 12 years. Yeah. And actually the problem is from the national education subject, the official teaching materials say that Chinese Communist Party is progressive, selfless, and united. And we think it's totally unacceptable, because actually for the different subject or the education and Hong Kong issue, enhance students to have independence of mind and critical thinking, not just to support and to be and to fully support the Communist Party, especially under the one party ruling whole of the China. Yeah.
So the entire curriculum was what, rejected or not accepted? What happened to it?
Actually, in 2012, while the government to launch this subject in all of the secondary school and primary school in the 1st of September, the first day that we need to go to school after the summer holiday. Scholarism, which means my organization, found in 2011, we have organized the Occupy Citizen Square movement. The first time also for other than Occupy Action, we also have three of the member of Scholarism, our student organization, to have the student hunger strike. It's the first time for secondary school student to join into hunger strike and lead a social movement in Hong Kong. And finally, I think around 120,000 Hong Kong citizens joined into the Occupy Citizen Square movement for more than 10 days. And we have increased the bargaining power of us, and we create a miracle. Finally, the government have put aside this subject on October of 2012. Yeah.
Some people will say, even when Hong Kong was under the British control, there was no universal suffrage. What's your comment on in regard to that?
actually since 4 years ago, while I'm entering the brainwashing education, I've already asked a lot of people who support the government of pro-Beijing already asked me, oh, why you do not anti-brainwash before 1997? Actually, my response is first, while Hong Kong is ruled by British, I'm still not exist in this world. I born in 1996, actually. Yeah. So it's not my problem. Yeah. And I think Hong Kong now, Hong Kong is a special SAR, special administrative region.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And in before 1997, we are just the colony under the rule of British. Actually, it's not reasonable for us to compare the political situation of before 1997 and now, because actually now we are already a special administration region. And I think the most significant reason is under Basic Law, it say that Hong Kong people can have universal suffrage. It have written in the Basic Law already on 25 years ago until now. Actually, while the Basic Law have endorsed and let Hong Kong citizens to have the universal suffrage already, we are just asking the ruling class and the Communist Party to commit on what they have support under the regulation or the detail and the Basic Law.
There's a fairly broad definition of universal suffrage, and the fact that even under what Beijing had proposed, the Hong Kong citizen still gets to cast their vote. It's just that the dispute centers around who gets to choose the candidates that the Hong Kong people gets to vote for, right? Everybody still has the vote, not necessarily the right to nominate or choose the finalist candidates. Isn't that the distinction or the difference?
Yeah, actually, and of course, if you refer to ICCPR, there are a lot of definition of what is universal suffrage all over the world. A lot of professors and some of the politicians, they will give the definition. But I think actually, we always say that we fight for no screening election, direct election, universal suffrage. From my point of view, I think the best for us is, of course, we can also get the right to vote in the election and also let all of the voters to get the direct right to nominate the chief executive candidate. Say, for example, if there are, I think, 50,000 people in Hong Kong that give out their signature to support one of the politicians, and that politician could be the CE candidate. But I think the most important problem is in Hong Kong actually there are around 45% of the voters they support the pro-Beijing politician, and around 55% of the voters or citizens support the pan-democrats councilor member of or politician. But under the current system, only the pro-Beijing politician can be the CE candidate and to run in the election. It's totally unreasonable. Could you imagine in US, in United States, all of the Republican can't run in the election, only those who are in Democratic Party or support Democratic Party can run in the election of the chief executive or the president in US. It's unreasonable at all. Yeah, so I think from my point of view, the only conclusion is the election should let different politicians with various background to enter to be the candidate. Yeah.
Okay. Well, you brought up the United States, and I'm sorry to say, United States is not necessarily a good model of open democracy or universal suffrage. It's the candidate who has the most money has the best chance to win.
Yeah, I know.
What do you feel has been accomplished as a result of the three months movement?
Actually, we have occupied for around 78 days. Actually, all of the thing is out of my expectation, because the trigger point of umbrella movement is usually start from, we hope to get back the citizen square, we climb the 3 meters barrier, try to enter the citizen square, and after that, a lot of student leader, including me, were arrested by the policeman, and the policeman used the tear gas and pepper spray to hurt us, and finally it triggered whole of the umbrella movement. All of the things are out of our expectation. I can't imagine, if you ask Joshua Wong last summer, could you imagine 3 months later in September that they will have a new occupy action? I would say no, I can't imagine. But I think from my point of view, I really need to admit that even with Occupy for nearly 3 months, we still can't get any positive results. We can't win in this battle.
What does ultimately, when you win, what does that mean?
Of course, if we say that what is the ultimate win is usually related to the value, what is freedom, justice, or democracy, but autonomy. But if you ask more, what is more valid request for us, what is the ultimate request for Hong Kong people? From my point of view, I think that is we should continue universal suffrage and autonomy for Hong Kong even after 2047. Mm-hmm. Because after umbrella movement, a lot of people, including me, we worry about now Hong Kong, we have the independence of law, we have freedom of speech, and we are, although we are part of China, we are one of the SAR. However, we are not sure that after 2047, it is sure that we will still be one of the SAR, or we will just turn back to one normal country in China, just like Guangzhou or Shenzhen. Yeah. So I think the direction for the Hong Kong citizen and activists is we'll concern more about the future problem of Hong Kong. After 2047, it is possible for us to protect our own right, freedom, and system.
There's a rumor that there's some leading university in America is offering you a full ride to enter a university in America. Is that true?
No, actually, of course, in the Hong Kong pro-Beijing newspaper already say that I get the fund from U.S. government, and some of the council members have a close relationship with Joshua Wong, and even the U.S. Army have trained Joshua Wong last year. It's report in the A1 headline of Hong Kong pro-Beijing newspaper named Men Hui Bo.
So you would agree with the observation that the democratic process in Hong Kong is still quite immature?
Yeah, it's quite immature, the democratic process, because in Hong Kong, the largest party in Hong Kong have only 20,000 members, named DAB, a pro-Beijing party. But if you ask, the majority in Hong Kong, nearly 60% of the voters support the pan-democrats. So how about the number of party members in Hong Kong and those pan-democrats party? The truth is the largest pan-democrats party named Democratic Party in Hong Kong have only just 700 members. Yeah. It's quite unreasonable for the largest opposite party have just only 700 members. So actually in Hong Kong, party is not really like a party compared to other foreign country.
So you have widely fragmented and splintered groups, would you say? Even doesn't matter which side you are on, whether you're in the pro-Beijing side or the pandemic side, you don't have one single unified voice.
Yeah, it's hard to get a unified voice. You say if After the political reform package is being voted down, all of the pro-Beijing councilor member, they try to push the responsibility to other councilor member or other politician in the same side of them. And even in Hong Kong, and the pan-democrat side that support democracy, actually they have different background, and actually it's hard for them to have the united action. Even in the umbrella movement, whether they should support the umbrella movement or not, it's necessary for the council member to be involved in civil disobedience. They still have diverse ideas. So it's hard. In Hong Kong, the truth is, no matter which side are you in, it's hard to get a unified or united voice. Yeah. But if we pass the political reform package, there are zero possibility for any pan Democrats to be the candidate. So from this point of view, actually vote down is still the best choice for them. Of course, the primary goal is to vote down the package, but actually the best choice for us, of course, is to get back the direct election and no screening election, that to let, no matter you are from the pro-Beijing side or the pan-Democrat side, you can still be the CE candidate. It should be a fair and more equal election in Hong Kong.
Now, to do that, realistically, in order to do that, you would almost have to rewrite the basic law or at least insert a very elaborate package to describe the whole process, wouldn't you?
Actually, if we need to get true universal suffrage, I mean, no screening, no matter you're from which side, you still can be the CE candidate. Actually, it's not necessary for us to rewrite the basic law. But I think no matter you want to get universal suffrage, direct election, or rewrite the basic law or not, actually it depends on the attitude of Beijing. But from my point of view, now, actually in these few weeks, we can see that the Communist Party continue to arrest a lot of lawyers and activists in mainland China. Mm-hmm. Actually, within this 1 or 2 years or few years, I don't see any possibility for Beijing to let Hong Kong to have universal suffrage. Yeah.
Apparently, you missed our first scheduled interview because you had some emergency meeting with your attorney, with your lawyer.
Yeah.
What's happening on your court appearance?
I've been arrested by policemen for 3 times, and actually, there are nearly 10 charges given by a policeman. But actually, I think in the next month, I need to go to the court again because they say that I have joined the unauthorized assembly and hurt one of the policemen and to restrict the policeman to execute their job, something like that. So, of course, there are a lot of political agenda behind those policemen but I still think that Hong Kong, we still have the rule of law. The judges can make the decision without any pressure from the pro-government side, people, or the Communist Party.
Are there any other thoughts or things that you want to make before we wrap up?
I think within this, I think we have just this interview less than half hour, and I can fully express my idea and whole of the process for Joshua Wong to involve in social movement from 14 years old to now I'm 18 years old. I think after umbrella movement, we still can't win the battle. A lot of people in foreign country may ask me, oh, so what's the next step for you guys? Is possible for you guys really get universal suffrage or direct election under the rule of Communist Party? Because in the history, none of the country can get democracy under the rule of Communist Party. I mean, while it's ruled by Communist Party, but you still can't have universal suffrage in your own country. It's impossible at all in the past. I mean, the history. But from my point of view is we can't lose hope because today actually the ruling class, they are dominating our future. But I think while we grow up, the day will come for us, the new generation, to decide the future. So no matter what happened to the protest movement, we hope the new generation can still reclaim the democracy that belongs to us, because time is on our side. So I'm still positive and optimistic to fight for our future.
I just want to very quickly say something and show you something, because there is a foundation to some of the Chinese media's take in Hong Kong on why Joshua is a puppet, you know, of the US. And it's amazing because, quite frankly, our government does make statements, and usually it's to a testimony before a Senate committee. As you know, it's very prominent. And back in December, Daniel Russell, Assistant Secretary of State, went and testified before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. And you can see the philosophy, the attitude that comes across, and you know, the Chinese media does read some of this stuff, you know, as well as the government and the officials in Beijing. But I bold purposely this particular line, and we do around the world, the United States advocates in China for internationally recognized fundamental freedoms, such as, et cetera. And then you go down here and they talk about prosperity and open expression, free market ideals. And then they throw in something that you have to kind of take a look at really carefully. Okay, one country, two systems, et cetera. Hong Kong currently ranks first in the Heritage Foundation's Index of Economic Freedom. The PRC, I would note, ranks 137. Does anybody know anything about the Heritage Foundation? Okay, I don't want to, because of time. It's one of the most conservative think tanks in the United States. When you see a testimony from a US government official citing this index of economic freedom, here's Hong Kong, wow, number one. They've been number one since 1995, according to the index. 20 years, number one. China is way down there, 137. And so they look at this, they say, where's the government point of view on this? So I just want to give you as a piece of evidence why some of this stuff comes out. Oh, he's gotten funding from the US government, you know, he's trained by the US Army. There's something to that, and because of what we say, and we kind of roll that into freedom, liberty, justice, and we say it internationally, you know, oh, all over the world we do that. So I just want to point that out as another primary document source you can use. The other one, you got to go to the basically what the August 31st document says. And that's another primary source document, of course, that you may want to use. Li Fei is the Beijing's guy, you know, heading this. And he went to Hong Kong a number of times and to make sure that the NPC's position is represented. And his statement, and there's more on him, but the way they see it is that universal suffrage, you know, in the selection of the CE, represents the historical progress in Hong Kong's democratic development. And they see it as democratic because even though, you know, there's only two or three you can vote on, over 5 million Hong Kong citizens can participate if you're 18 or over. You can vote for one of those, you know, two or three. In the entire history of Hong Kong under the British, there were 28 governors, okay, from 1843 until Chris Patten left. In 1997, all of the governors were appointed by the British monarch, starting with Queen Victoria, all the way down to Queen Elizabeth. So from the Chinese point of view, that's their democracy. They're giving everybody a vote on those two or three candidates. So, and of course, love their country, love Hong Kong, and so on and so forth. And you have to contrast this to what Joshua says, because he says something very quickly, you may not have caught in his interview. He says something about the ICCPR. That refers to the United Nations High Command on Human Rights, a covenant adopted in 1966 that refers to the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. So in the basic law, a lot of stuff that were on the international level adopted and put into the basic law, he is digging up to throw in the face of the Chinese government. You see? Hey, Deng Xiaoping and Margaret Thatcher, they all agreed to this. How come you are not doing this? So the guy, the young man, 18 years old, is digging up this stuff, he's sprouting it. But it's not without fact or foundation. Because you look at the basic law, it's in there. It's a long list of that, and there's stuff about economic freedom, social freedom, culture freedom, due process, you know, you're innocent until proven guilty, all those things that we are familiar with in the Western world. It's in there. So that's why he goes back there and throws it back at the Chinese government's face. So anyway, I stopped just to give a comparison for your use in the classroom. But now I really want to go to George and, of course, Tom, because that interview or interviews, I think, needs to be really discussed and that you have a chance to interact with them. So with that, we go to George and Tom.
Okay. Should I go first?
Yes, please. All the way to quarter two.
I'll make mine real quick so that we can get some audience reaction. I do want to explain that the LegCo election, which took place between Nicole's interview and Joshua's interview. The Legislative Council in Hong Kong was supposed to vote on whether to accept Beijing's proposal or not. It turned out to be a real fiasco because, as I think Nicole explained, you need to have two-thirds majority in order to approve or disapprove the legislation. And it wasn't going to happen either direction because neither side had two-thirds of the vote. So when they started the voting, the pro-Beijing side, which still consisted of a great majority of the members of the council, all of a sudden decided to get up and leave. And the reason they decided to get up to leave was because one of their member, who is always late to the Legislative Council meetings, was on his way, and they wanted to delay until he shows up so that they can add one more vote to their side. And they asked the presiding chairman to hold off the vote. And the presiding chairman, although he is known to be on the pro-Beijing side, still he was the presiding chairman. He went according to the rules, and he says, hey, wait, you can't do that because we already started the voting process. Nevertheless, because of a mix-up, the whole majority got up and left. So what was left was the anti-side, and now they have two-thirds majority to vote this thing down. And so this thing got shot down, okay? So when I asked Joshua about the immaturity of the Hong Kong democratic process, we had discussed this whole fiasco predecessor to leading to this discussion about the immaturity of Hong Kong process. I just want to make one additional observation. Nicole helped his uncle write the autobiography called A Dragon and the Crown, and I read it. It's a wonderful, terrific book about the history of Hong Kong. The wealthy, the fairly well-to-do Hong Kong Chinese before World War II, even before the Republican days, when it was still under the Qing Empire, under the British control, typically it's one man, multiple wives. And if you're not the oldest son of the first wife, you have to make, and it's going to be a big family of lots of kids. And typically, if you're not the oldest son of the first wife, you're going to have to struggle to find your way and in the world. And Nicole's uncle, Stanley Kwan, who was famous for developing the Hang Seng Index, that was his legacy to Hong Kong, which is like the Dow Jones of the US, he was not number one son. His father was not number one son. His father only married one wife. So it's the grandfather, the father was not the number one, so he had to make do. But what was interesting about his time was that under the British, the schools in the British colony can teach whatever they want. And certain schools taught a lot about Chinese history and culture. And that's one of the schools that Stanley Kwan went to. Consequently, during the Japanese World War II, he was very patriotic. He went into China to fight on the KMT side. And because he also learned English, he became an interpreter between the American soldiers and the Chinese side. And even though he didn't get to go to college, that made his career. Now, I'm reflecting on the 14-year-old who could have been one of your students, thinking about, we don't want anything having to do with a national education curriculum because we don't want to be corrupted by whatever the Beijing line of thinking is. And I'm thinking, what a tragic decision it is for the young people in Hong Kong, because there's no question in my mind the future of the next generation of Hong Kong people are going to be tied to the fortunes of China. There's no ifs and buts about it. Even the people in Taiwan understands this, even if they don't want it or don't accept it. And that's going to be the tragedy of Hong Kong. Yours.
Okay, well, I have a whole lot of things to say and only a short period of time. Let me first of all pick up on some things that Paul said. I think there's a difference between economic freedom and political freedom. And if that's ranking Hong Kong number one on economic freedom, it says nothing about political freedom. And in China, 137th, we know that the Chinese economy, for all of the reforms that have been undertaken, there still is a central role for the state. State ownership, state planning, state financing, state regulation. So I don't think that's a proper comparison, a proper thing to refer to. On the question of loving the country and loving Hong Kong, this gets to many of the points that Tom Klitgaard made yesterday, and I'm going to refer to that in my own presentation, is this vagueness. What does it mean to love Hong Kong? What does it mean to love the country? How do you demonstrate that? Do you roll over and slobber at Beijing? Or do you say, yeah, I accept one country, two systems, but Hong Kong should have its own system. This shows that I support China, I love China, right? I mean, but what does love the country mean? So that gets to the national education thing. Does it mean learning about China, or does it mean learning that the Communist Party is correct and should be the final arbiter of everything that happens in Hong Kong? All of these things are vague, and they leave a large room for interpretation. And I think one of the things that the movement last year did was to raise a lot of issues that had not been publicly discussed and things that were coming to a head. I went to Hong Kong I arrived in Hong Kong the night of June 3rd, 1989, on my way to Beijing because I'd been hired to work on a documentary by a journalist I will not name. And I could not get a Chinese visa, so I went to Hong Kong because they said you can get a visa there, which I ended up getting. But I went to bed, and then I got in the night of the 3rd, I went to bed, I woke up in the morning of the 4th, watched what was going on on television, and I said, I have to do something. And so people said, there's a big demonstration in Happy Valley. So I went to Happy Valley and I marched with somewhere between 1 and 2 million people. This was Hong Kong's baptism, political baptism. So people had said up to that time, Hong Kong people are only interested in making money. They're not interested in politics. Well, this showed that they were interested in politics. And to this day, there has been an increased politicization of the people of Hong Kong. And someone like Joshua Wong, who's extraordinarily articulate, you know, I think, in English, in Cantonese, I'm sure he's even more powerful when he stands up. And the guy probably doesn't weigh 100 pounds soaking wet. But he really projects. I think that came through there. This demonstrates that the youth in Hong Kong, many of the youth, we can't overgeneralize, but that certainly among a segment of the population in Hong Kong, there has been this politicization and this asking about a lot of questions. And I think that the demonstrations in Hong Kong last fall, and I was in Hong Kong in early December when they had begun to peter out, but I still went to the demonstrations, and I interviewed a lot of, and also the local Hong Kong Economic and Trade Office arranged for me to interview a lot of government officials, including the key advisors to the chief executive, CE. Josh refers to CE as the chief executive. Three of his top advisors. So I was getting a broad spectrum of views. And I think it's critical to realize that the demonstrations in Hong Kong, like the demonstrations in Taiwan in April, March and April before that, they're a very complex mixture of issues that are being discussed. This is just the tip, the basic law discussion, or in Taiwan right now, the Ministry of Education, or what was going on in last April was about economic arrangements with China are just the tip of the iceberg. And during the demonstrations in Hong Kong and the demonstrations in Taiwan, both of the movements used a popular Western, actually, song from the musical Les Miserables as their anthem. And you know what that is? Do you hear the people singing the song of angry men, translated into Mandarin and Cantonese, and appropriate to their, so that this showed that they felt that they were expressing, do you hear the people sing? That they were expressing a lot of things which had been bottled up for a long time. So it may have, there were certain precipitating factors, but they represented a much deeper set of dissatisfaction, such as what we see happening in Hong Kong right now and in Taiwan right now, issues of academic freedom. Issues of academic freedom. Issues of freedom of the freedom of speech and freedom of the media. Inequality. Chances of mobility. Job opportunities. Unaffordable housing. The fact that people from the mainland are going to Hong Kong in particular, buying up milk powder, buying up all sorts of, because of contaminated milk powder in China, buying up all sorts of food products because of food safety problems in China, which then drive up the price of food, that they are buying up all sorts of goods and then going back across the border, the trains run sort of every 10 or 15 minutes, and selling their arbitrage between the prices they buy things in Hong Kong and what they can sell them for in China. So the people in Hong Kong, which is right on the border, you just take the train, people in Taiwan, where now you can fly back and forth, see this increasing encroachment of China into their daily lives and don't like it. There are some people who do like it. Some members of the media, some members of the economic elite who are benefiting wildly from this, and they support it. But beneath the surface, there is a tremendous wellspring of unhappiness. Do you hear the people sing? And I think it's really critical that we're aware of that, that so much of this frustration aimed at the chief executive and the government in Hong Kong and the government in Taiwan is really aimed at Beijing and what they see as toadying to Beijing, and that Beijing is increasingly encroaching on their freedoms. So that's just a few of my reactions. One other point I want to make, and it keeps coming up, this question of influence. Again, what does influence mean? You've got open society. Hong Kong is one of the world's most open societies. Taiwan is one of the world's most open societies media-wise. They read the press. They're on all, you know, WeChat and QQ and Facebook and Twitter and all of these different things. They know what's going on all around the world. Of course, they're influenced by that. Does that mean that there's a secret plot by Congress or the British Parliament to find a 14-year-old kid and turn him into an icon of democracy? I doubt it. The U.S. former U.S. Consul General has said no, he was not involved in manipulating Joshua Wong or any of these demonstrations. Is the U.S. Congress, is the British Parliament concerned about these issues? Yes, they are, but are they manipulating them? I don't think so. I think that they spring internally from the contradictions within Hong Kong within Taiwan.
A friend of mine in Hong Kong, a very influential person, did tell me that at the basement of the Mormon church in the critical area in Occupy Central was where they were handing out food boxes, bottles of water,
George, that's
et cetera.
Not organizing and getting them out on 79 days occupying the central part of Hong Kong.
So there is some organizations supporting the protests. Can that be considered outside influence? Well, I don't know.
That's a whole different. Obviously, we don't agree on
it. Okay. Tom made a terrific presentation yesterday about the May 4th movement. I would want to make a distinction between the May 4th movement of what year was that?
19.
Right. Those were the elites of the Chinese youth. They went to the exclusive schools. They have plenty of education, training, and thinking. I question whether Joshua Wong, who went to Open University in Hong Kong, which is the lowest barrier of entry to the universities in Hong Kong, whether the, he represents the elite of the Hong Kong youth.
No, he doesn't. But you know, the thing, the demonstration initially, there were three professors, one of whom is a friend of mine at Chinese University of Hong Kong, a sociologist, though I had nothing to do with it. You know, you can't accuse me. He went to Yale. Yale was the one that...
You were paid by the CIA to go over there.
Everybody knows that. It was a professor from CUHK, a law professor from University of Hong Kong, and I forget the third one, who organized a movement called Occupy Central with Peace and Love.
Yeah,
Benny Tai. I forget the third one's name. But they were going to occupy this, and they had set this out, but the students, led by Joshua, usurped it. So initially, it was an elite movement. But the point is, do you hear the people saying, this is no longer just an elite. This is people, this represents something that is percolated up from the bottom. Just one final point.
Tom, you got talent. You should sing that the whole thing through.
Boy, do you not want to hear me sing. Just one final point.
I don't think
it's fair or accurate to compare British colonial administration of Hong Kong with what's happened since 1997. Hong Kong was a colony of the United Kingdom, and there's no question about that. And when Chris Patten came in, one of the things that he did was introduce elections for urban councils and open up the elections to LegCo, Legislative Council, and so on. You could say it was completely cynical, and there probably was a certain amount of cynicism. But now Hong Kong is, as Joshua keeps saying, is part of this. It's part of China. It's supposed to have a different set of rights than it had under the British. You had no expectations. So comparing to say that for 150 years you couldn't elect your leaders in Hong Kong, well, it was a colony.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. Now it's not supposed to be a colony.
I think it's voiced because this is what some of the Chinese faction pro-Beijing people are saying. I think it's okay to present that because, you know, if you're going to ask students to analyze what they're saying and also what they're doing, you know. And I think it's fair, although historically, I think there are ways in which you can absolutely say this is a British colony or this is a whatever colony. And because of that, nothing can be changed. But I think how they see it, it's the perception thing. And I think that gets to the heart of what I think we need to have more discussion on. And that is going to generate questions. So let's go to Peter. Peter, go ahead. And do we have a mic, please, for Peter? And others, please jump in. We're going to extend this a little bit because I think you got questions, I see.
Yeah, two quick questions. Did you believe him when he said that he had not been offered a full free ride scholarship by a university here in the United States? And the second question, by chance, are we going to be able to see the New York Times video that you're referring to earlier where he's on the streets? Are we going to get a chance to see that?
No, not in this, but I can certainly give you the website. You just go online, you know, New York Times. It's widely available in choices as well. Okay.
Let me just quickly answer the question. I don't have a belief one way or the other, and there was so much stuff floating around about how Joshua got a full ride that I thought I'd give him a chance to clarify. The only precedent that I had to go on was after June 4th, 1989, one of the leading dissidents of the Tiananmen incident did get a full ride to Harvard, and his name was Wu Er Kai Shi.
No, it's Wang Dan.
Huh?
Wang Dan.
Wang Dan.
Wang Dan got a full ride to Harvard. Wu Er Kai Shi did not.
But he did go to Harvard.
I don't think Wu Er Kai Shi went to Harvard.
Yeah, he was at Harvard for a while. He ended up pumping gas for all you, any of you interested in what happened to him.
Now he's a businessman in Taiwan, married to a starlet. So, and running for the Legislative Yuan.
Yeah, right.
I have no information on that at all. As far as I know, Berkeley has not offered him a scholarship. if he can catch a football, then maybe they could. Oh, I didn't say that.
Go ahead, Greg.
And mine's probably just more a comment, and I am struck by, just like yesterday, the speakers who presented about China hit that big point that it's complex. And Mr. Kickard introduced Greater China, to us, and here with Hong Kong, it's a complex issue. I guess I'm also struck by, here's a young man, even from the age of 14 and now 18, who's a political activist, very involved, as Dr. Gold said, you know, very well spoken, and it just makes me think, you know, how do we capture his excitement and interest in politics and then bring that into our classroom to try and, you know, energize and excite, you know, teenagers here in the U.S. who, you know, all too often I think come into the class with a little bit of apathy. And you know, it's impressive here, I hear him ending with, you know, time is on our side. So it shows a maturity that's far, you know, beyond his years. And so, you know, again, that seems like our charge. How do we develop more Joshua Wongs here in the United States?
Any reaction to that statement?
In somebody else's class.
I am much too old to get excited about the American political system.
Watch the debates this Thursday. Go ahead. There's a question in the back. Can you bring her the microphone? I thought I saw your hand. Yeah. No, oh, it wasn't you. Okay. Anybody else? Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Does this work? Okay. I read somewhere that someone was saying that the British government had actually tried to introduce more democracy into Hong Kong, but the Chinese government had resisted that. Is that just a PR thing by the British government, or do you know anything about that?
Well, apparently there is that, there is evidence of that.
I think
that the Chinese opposed, that there was Chinese, Beijing opposition to what Chris Patten was doing. Chris Patten was the final governor.
Right. And what Chris Patten, at least what Beijing accused Chris Patten of trying to do, was to leave a legacy system that he was not willing to put in while he was governor, but to leave, let the Beijing government, when they take over, inherit a system that Beijing didn't have any say on. And that was what they're objecting to.
But it did get going under his governorship.
Others?
So much of education tends, in the past, in my experience, to be boring and reading books that pass tests instead of finding constructive ways to get engaged and make a difference in the world. So how can we inspire them to be constructive, not just protest, but actually get engaged and be constructive in making their society and the world a better place?
Well, this was one of the points that Mary Kay was making in her discussion of civil society, and I'm a big believer in nonprofits. You know, why are we active in the 1990 Institute? Because, you know, like the young high school student who was here helping out yesterday. I mean, I think that's the model, is getting involved in civil society, right? And in our, who quoted de Tocqueville yesterday? Tom was quoting de Tocqueville. Right, and de Tocqueville said, what struck him about America was that Americans identify a problem and they don't wait for somebody to tell them what to do. They organize a group to address a particular problem. That's part of our strength. That's one of the things that foreigners notice about us. And that's what I think. That's my advice.
How many years ago was that, the Tocqueville
observation? 1830s. He's still right. He nailed it. That book is relevant. And as I think maybe, I don't know, as you said, there's two great things: democracy in America, which is his vision of his view of America in 1832 as a French nobleman, not long after the French Revolution, where many of his relatives were, and the ancient regime, l'ancien regime, which is about the collapse of nobility. And of course, I can't remember again if it was you yesterday, Tom, was talking about the Chinese communist elite studying the Soviet Union. They're also reading de Tocqueville.
Right.
Why do authoritarian regimes collapse? And how can we prevent that from happening?
Yes,
and it's still relevant to this day.
Interesting about de Tocqueville, he said that the Americans are interested only in money. Really, they're avaricious for money. That was so
He's basic. Right.
And you look at Hong Kong, and you can see a certain amount of parallelism, and also China. But I would recommend everybody just go online and go on Google. They have de Tocqueville's maybe 50 or 60 most important statements. And they're fantastic. They relate right to today. And you can relate to them and so on.
I would think that it's safe to say that he did not anticipate the Supreme Court decision on Citizen United and that where all the money counts and votes, not too much.
I think on that note, I want to thank George and Tom for a very spirited exchange, and the audience, thank you so much.